Bueno, pues voy a aprovechar también como exalumna de la primera generación para, pues sí, para tener el privilegio de hacer un par de comentarios. Me parece importante celebrar, pues no solo un programa, sino el esfuerzo de mucha gente, como ya comentaban Alberto y Liliana, porque el programa se hizo, pues eso, con trabajo colectivo, como ya lo señalaron, el esfuerzo de mucha gente, gente que sigue aquí, que sigue como comprometida, Ileana, Marían, Anne, Juan Carlos, y gente nueva también, ¿no? Como Ana, Enrique, que se han ido sumando y que han hecho el proyecto suyo. Y también gente que para mí como egresada de la primera generación también fue muy importante, Claudia Magallanes, Anthony Castells, Nacho Padilla, como ya mencionaron, Raúl Calderón. Y seguramente se me están yendo muchos otros nombres, pero que ya como tenemos poco tiempo. Pero otra cosa que estamos celebrando es lo que a mi juicio fue uno de los grandes aciertos del programa de doctorado, que fue el grupo de investigación en teorías del arte y los medios contemporáneos. Ese proyecto, por lo menos en un inicio para la primera generación, pero sé que para los compañeros con los que después tuve contacto de otras generaciones, surgió como un intento de materializar lo que se discutía en clases, que tenía que ver con repensar las estructuras de poder, con dar voces, voz a otras perspectivas, con tratar de generar un ambiente más horizontal y colaborativo en los procesos de construcción del conocimiento. ¿Sí? Y ese proyecto tuvo muchos altibajos, pero uno de los grandes saltos fue cuando obtuvimos fondos de CONACYT para desarrollar el proyecto La epistemología más allá del texto, prácticas culturales en la era de la información. Otro que también era difícil de recordar. Ese proyecto tomó varios intentos de pedir los fondos, intentos fallidos. También requirió darle a Juan Carlos Reyes, que no está aquí, pero muchos brownies para que siguiera en la computadora subiendo ¿no? y negociar la plataforma de CONACYT y subir toda la información. Pero después de un par de años y varios intentos, logramos obtener los fondos y, pues bueno, después de un congreso internacional, varias residencias académicas, invitados, un par de libros que ya verán la luz del día el siguiente año, ponencias, una página web y muchos, muchos dolores de cabeza. Este día, digamos que con esto cerramos ese proyecto que desarrollamos pues ya en total en 5 años y lo vamos a cerrar con la conferencia de Sandra Harding, Rear Guard Research, Creating New Proper Knowing Self. I'm going to start speaking in English from now on, but I think we could not have asked for a better suitor for our project. So we're truly honored. Sandra Harding is a distinguished research professor of education and gender studies at the University of California, Los Angeles. She's a philosopher. She taught for 2 decades at the University of Delaware before moving to UCLA in 1996. She directed the UCLA Center for the Study of Women from 1996 until 2000. The year 2000, and co-edited the journal Science, Journal of Women in Culture and Society from the year 2000 until 2005. She was also a distinguished affiliate professor of philosophy at Michigan State University from 2010 until 2014. In 2013, she was awarded the John Desmond Bernal Award by the Society for the Social Studies of Science for distinguished contributions to the field contributions to the field. Previous recipients included Thomas Kuhn, Robert Merton, Joseph Needham, and Mary Douglas. She's the author or editor of 17 books and special journal issues, including Objectivity and Diversity, Another Logic of Scientific Research, Is Science Multicultural, Postcolonialisms, Feminism, and Epistemologies, and Design Questioning Feminism, among many others. She has been a visiting professor at the University of Amsterdam, the University of Costa Rica, the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, and the Asian Institute of Technology. She has been a consultant to several United Nations organizations, including the Pan American Health Organization, UNESCO, the UN Development Fund for Women, and the UN Commission on Science and Technology for Development. Welcome.
Thank you so much, and it's a great pleasure to be here. And I thank Leandro and your wonderful program for inviting me. It's very inspiring. 10 years in an established PhD program is a really important thing to celebrate. not all programs get there in the kind of wonderful way that your program has. Well, as the title of my talk probably indicated to some of you, I'm afraid I'm going to bore half of you and mystify the other half. So I'm going to go over some work that will be familiar to many of you and hopefully move beyond it in some ways.
You keep talking and I'll just bring it close to you.
Okay, and let's try this out and see if I can.
Yeah.
I'm a shouter, actually, but those big introduction classes, right? Can you hear me in the back? If you can't, or if I'm speaking too fast, raise your hand and I'll try to slow down and speak more clearly.
Yeah.
Thank you. So, the social justice movements that emerged beginning in the 1960s, and of course I'm going to be thinking here primarily about the United States, with which I'm most familiar, but not exclusively. These social justice movements all had researched agendas. They all produced, as Boaventura de Sousa Santos has said, rear guard research. That is, they started off research from the issues that mattered to the civil rights movement, poor people's movements, the women's movement, anti-colonial movements, very soon disability movements, lesbian, gay, bi, trans, skipping 40 years or so, the Occupy movements, the Arab Spring. We could go on. All of these social justice movements needed to know things about the world that they were blocked from knowing. It wasn't an accident that it was hard to figure out that women's work was really work. That there were all kinds of mystifications, for example, of women's inherent natural abilities to wash socks, you know, and so forth. And so it took a lot of work to develop the research agendas and the point where I kind of, in my own history, entered these issues, how to justify them. How to justify, as objective research, research that started off from women's lives. And everybody knows women aren't objective, right? And yet, researchers needed grants from the National Science Foundation, they needed jobs, they needed tenure. The research programs needed a research infrastructure that recognized the importance of the issues that the social justice movements were raising for everyone, not only for the African Americans that were the immediate cause of the rise of the civil rights movement. And the problem was that the dominant norms of research featured this person. I call him Mr. Nowhere. He was supposed to be able to see everywhere in the world from no particular location in it, right? A good researcher distanced himself, that was the good researcher, from the objects of his study, kept a distance, cool, didn't get co-opted into the views that the indigenous people or the women or the workers or the poor people or the lesbian, gay, bi, trans, whomsoever. However, a fundamental theme of these social justice movements, though they didn't say it in this way, was that sciences and their societies co-produce each other. That way of saying it was developed by a new field of academic research called science and technology studies, or more precisely, the social studies of scientific knowledge. And they articulated it in that particular way. But when you look back at the civil rights research, the poor people's research, when you start looking in the social sciences, for example, at participatory action research, that whole continuum of different kinds of activities that began with the attempt in the U.S., I just don't know the history elsewhere, but in the U.S. it was an attempt to give poor people a voice in the poverty programs, anti-poverty programs that came in the Johnson administration primarily. And so these social justice movements argued, for example, that a colonial society will produce colonial sciences that in turn provide resources for a colonial society. So it's a mutual relationship. And this little innocent way of putting the issue completely undermined a model of good research that had begun in the Enlightenment, right? Galileo, anybody can see through my telescope and so forth. I mean, all the, and gotten immensely strengthened in the 1950s and 60s when the Vienna Circle, this group of scientist philosophers from Austria and Germany, as the Vienna Circle, had a powerful political research program. They were calling for all scientists to direct their attention to the kinds of social problems visible in Germany and Austria in the 1930s that the fascists were beginning to solve in their own hideous ways. So the model, the positivist, as it's referred to in the social sciences, the logical positivist or logical empirical researchers, philosophers talk about it. It got created in its present form through a politics. It was not handed down from Mount Olympus, right? Completely intact and perfectly true. It was developed as a reaction, as a response, as a defense against what happened when Carnap and Reichenbach and a whole bunch of other German and Austrian, mostly, physicist philosophers, all of whom were socialists, most of whom were Jews, arrived in the US and encountered what? McCarthyism and the Cold War, which both were anti-Semitic in addition to being anti-commie. There's a wonderful new history of this era that came out a few years ago. It's by George Reich, and it's entitled How the Cold War Transformed the Philosophy of Science, colon, to the Icy Slopes of Logic. And it's a study of the correspondence between Carnap and Reichenbach, both of whom were in my department. When I first came to UCLA, my office was in the philosophy department, and I had Carnap's office. And my philosophy of science teacher had been a student of Carnap's. And we had a moment of silence every October 15th, or whatever the date was, in my philosophy of science class to commemorate Carnap's birthday. And so there I was in Carnap's office, but I was already a traitor to the cause, right? Carnap would have felt ambivalent about me. And I felt ambivalent about him. Okay, let me move on. I'm having too good a time here. So what I want to turn to today is how these social justice movements produced new methodologies of research, new methodologies, we could say methods, but I am cautious about that because I think research methods stay pretty constant across changes and everything else. I mean, you do interviews and surveys and so forth and so on. The theory of how to do research, what a research design should look like, the theory of method does change at various times. And my argument is that it has radically changed as a result of the projects of these new social justice movements. So what I'm going to do now, and where did Andrew go? I need to ask him a question. How many? So 45 minutes, or when should I stop?
45 minutes? You need 45 minutes?
Should I stop at like 12? Half an hour from now? We cut me off because I keep going forever. With a responsive audience, you know, at 5 o'clock, I'd still be telling you about my graduate school days.
12:15 is fine.
Yeah, that's more than enough. Thank you. Okay, so what I want to do is first talk about the new methods, and then talk about the new kinds of proper scientific selves that have come out of this research. And I'm going to begin with a quotation from a wonderful book entitled Objectivity by the two historians of science, Lorraine Bastin and Peter Galison. And here's the quotation early on in the book. So the title, let me say a couple things. The title of the book is Objectivity. It came out, 10 years ago. And it's a study of atlases, you know, all these perfect lithographs of bougainvillea or violets or something, and destined, you know, in the, of the heavens, right, of all kinds of natural phenomena. And Dastin and Galison point out that these atlases functioned as the internet of their day. They allowed scientists who were separated by space or time to work together on the kinds of classifying projects that these atlases allowed them to do. So the botanist could carry his atlas of violets of the Amazon with him, and when some beautiful little item turned up, he could check it against the page and try to figure out if it was just another example of an existing known one or a different one. Okay, so in the standards for what counted as right sight shifted in the mid-19th century with the emergence of mechanical modes of representation. Let's think of photographs in particular, but there were all, medicine had all kinds of mechanical modes of representation and so forth. And the theme of the major defense of these mechanical modes of representation was these representations are untouched by human hands. This was obviously before Photoshop, right? Or before Stalin was eliminating the members of his cabinet he didn't approve of. Okay, so here's the standards for what constituted right sight and therefore objectivity shifted in the mid-19th century. And that shift is a major feature of Dastin and Galison's studies, though they come on up to the nanotechnologies and so forth. They look at other shifts. So here's the quote. What is the nature of objectivity? First and foremost, objectivity is the suppression of some aspect of the self, the countering of subjectivity. Objectivity and subjectivity define each other like left and right, or up and down. One cannot be understood, even conceived, without the other. If objectivity was summoned into existence to negate subjectivity, then the emergence of objectivity must tally with the emergence of a certain kind of willful self, one perceived as endangering scientific knowledge. The history of objectivity therefore, becomes part of the history of the self, or more precisely, of the proper scientific self. And so my argument is going to be these methodologies have produced a shift in right sight that produces a very different kinds of proper scientific selves. So first of all, I'm going to review as one form of this new methodology of the social justice movements. I'm going to review standpoint theory and my own proposal for strong objectivity, but as I'll say later, there are many other ways in which this new kind of methodology has been articulated, and I'll turn to that shortly. Okay, so the question is how to maximize objectivity for rear guard science, for knowledge production that starts off from the values and interests, social, political, economic values and interests of social justice movements. You can see the problem already for NSF, right? Okay. So the conventional notion of maximizing objectivity requires it to be the researcher to maximize freedom from values and interests in the results of research. And there are many ways in which this is policed and achieved, but a central one is to repeat observations across individuals or laboratories or field sites, right? So if Leandro does a set of observations and comes up with one answer, and I try to repeat them and come up with a different answer, you all can look at our published accounts and you can say, oh, we know why that happened. That's because Sandra was making sexist assumptions and Leandro was not. And so the conventional standard for objectivity, I want you all to be clear what I think about it, is excellent, excellent for identifying social values and interests that differ between individuals or research teams of one sort or another. But what if both Leandro and I are Eurocentric or making colonial assumptions? There's nothing in that practice that's going to turn that up. So the problem, first problem here with the conventional notion of objectivity is that it has no, I would say no resources to identify social values and interests that are shared across individuals or research communities, or maybe 500 years of research, right? Nobody's gonna get a Nobel Prize for being a sexist. You know, it's not an individual achievement. it's a collective part of history with a lot of ramifications. But there's a second problem with that conventional notion, and that is that once you all detect that sexism has shaped my results of research, but not Leandro's, one's supposed to eliminate them. Well, that's fine for sexism, but clearly, there are some social, political values and interests that advance the growth of knowledge, such as the feminism that you all had that enabled you to detect my sexist assumptions. So not all social, political values and interests obstruct the reliability and validity of the results of research, which leaves us with leaves researchers and actually leaves theorists, I guess, more than researchers, with a very different set of questions. Namely, what values and interests do advance the growth of research? Okay, so let me just make a little side comment on that. The historian of science, Robert Proctor, had pointed out decades ago that it was a mistake to conflate the absence of social values and interests in the results of research with the reliability of that research, number one, and and the reverse, right? To presume that results of research that exhibited values and interests were always therefore damaging to the reliability of that research. And so my examples for you to think about are that, after all, guns shoot straight, even though it's military values and interests that have directed the funding and the project of the research. There's nothing about those. There are societies that are not, don't have military values, that don't believe in shooting people. I don't happen to live in one of those societies. Maybe you do. Not me. Well, down here, maybe. I don't know. Nobody thinks that the aspirin won't work because corporate greed directed developing some minuscule little adjustment in the pharmaceutical so that they could make more money. Nobody thinks that environmental research is unreliable because the people who did it cared about the environment. And we can see that shift in values and interests, right? Nobody was talking about environmental people, almost nobody. More, you know, 50 years ago, Rachel Carson is, what, 60 years ago or something? That's a very distinctive social value and interest. And we could say the same thing about health research. So what I'm pointing out is that, I'm giving examples of what Bob Proctor meant, that there's a confusion here in presuming that all values and interests needed must be absent from research, and that the presence of very clearly political values and interests always damages the epistemic value, the scientific value of the research. Okay, so so what's the solution? In case anybody here is mystified, what's the solution of the social justice movements to this problem? Well, I started out by telling you the answer, namely rear guard research. Right, to start off research from the everyday lives of people who have, who are socially and politically vulnerable and who often have suffered most from the existing ways of doing it. And the example I want to use, especially if I can get my eyeballs on that, where did it go here, is women's work. And I teach a course on women, gender, and development regularly. Graduate school. And a big issue in the feminist analyses of third world development is the problem with how work, women's work, has been defined. There's a lot of other issues they raise that are important, but they fundamentally come to the conclusion, and did many years ago, that women's labor subsidizes market economies, and it subsidizes the irresponsible behavior of states who do not take responsibility for all 100% of their citizens. And so the feminists have done a whole bunch of, starting from women's lives, in order to rethink what work, what labor, what women's, what work is, who's poor. It turns out, I don't know, I know there's some social scientists in the room who have better statistics at their command than I do, but something like 80% of the poor in the world are women and their dependents, which includes, the dependents include children, the elderly, the sick. And so the kinds of work that women do with their, for their households and dependents has only recently begun to be included in international labor statistics, with one exception. And that is that the ILO, the International Labor Organization, has always had better statistics on women, women's work than anybody else. So what did feminists do? First of all, they had to redefine women's work as serious work. Elder care, child care, caring for the sick, sex work, that's a kind of caring labor, domestic labor, part-time labor, household manufacturing, having a child with you in the fields when you're doing agricultural labor, the informal economy, community labor, where neighbors cook and take care of each other's kids and so forth. There's probably others, but all of these kinds of women's labor were not counted in any measures of who was working. Right, those were reasons. Anybody who was working only part-time, only seasonally, had children with them, was doing household labor, X, Y, Z, was not, that was not counted as labor. It's clear that the fully healthy male laborer was the model of a worker, and that's an important worker, important kind of worker, but there are many other important kinds of work. A second problem was that when development aid was delivered, it was done in a trickle-down mode. It was presumed that if you gave aid to the head of the household, it would trickle down to everybody. And I won't go into the details, but some of you can think from your own households when that actually happens, right? And when it doesn't. And so that's a second problem, important problem. If women's needs are not directly addressed, they will not be satisfied, right? Because it's not men primarily, it's the institutions of society that require women's work to be ignored because it's very expensive. A lot of people have to give up a lot if women are to get equal pay for equal worth, so to speak. So this kind of analysis now, a number of feminists, economists particularly, but also political philosophers like Alison Jagger, are arguing there's no way that global poverty is going to be seriously reduced until women's needs are directly addressed. It's precisely the failure to address women's needs that that results in the increasing gap between the rich and poor during the development era, both locally and globally. So this is just one example of how starting off research from the daily lives of a vulnerable group results in new understandings of those people's lives in their terms. Secondly, new understandings of the dominant institutions using the conceptual framework of those who suffer from it, not those who benefit from them. And third, the relationship between those dominant institutions and what happens in everyday life. How does women's labor affect what happens in those dominant institutions? So standpoint theorists, one of the ones that sociologists are usually most familiar with, is the Canadian sociologist of knowledge, Dorothy Smith. She's done many books by now on this. And her focus on studying institutions and how their behaviors, their policies and practices shape daily lives, and vice versa. How the fact that the people who work in the full time in those major institutions do not have to take care of their own bodies, their children, their household environments. I, as one of those people in the dominant institutions, show up in class September 15th or whatever, and I never think about the fact that most of the people in front of me are supposed to be there. How did that happen? I didn't make that happen. I dragged out my old wrinkled lecture notes from last year, Xeroxed them so I could read them, and walked to the class. I wasn't in the registrar's office. I didn't clean the offices. I wasn't their therapist trying to get them to class one way or the other. I wasn't dealing with their financial problems, X, Y, Z. So these institutional positions blind us to how the society actually works. And in order to understand that, one has to do research from below, right? One has to start off from that, not just neglected, but denied, right? I mean, not at an intentional level also, but often at an intentional level. I could go into that, but I won't. Back to Harry Truman and his great second inaugural address about who was going to have to suffer. Okay. So strong objectivity is a new, is what I call maximizing reliability and validity through this kind of process. It's a different, as I subtitled my last book, it's another logic of scientific research. I'm mimicking Carnap and Popper and so forth in that subtype. It's a different logic of research than positivism in that tradition had developed. When I started off, I said I was going to talk about standpoint theory, but that's just one way of articulating this kind of logic of research. And I mentioned along, you're probably familiar more with participatory action research. I mean, there's a whole continent of these kinds of practices. Ruth Santos is clearly talking about that with his Riverguard theory. Gloria Anzaldúa and Walter Mignolo are talking about it when they talk about borderlands research. The way I think about it is that every time a new group steps on the stage of history, one thing they say is, gee whiz, things look different from the perspective of my life, right? So the Latin American decolonial theory is challenging the way postcolonialism was conceptualized. Postcolonial theory started off from the British Empire in India in the mid-18th century. What about 1492, may we ask? We have some 16th century buildings here, right? I'm so excited. Go see them. Okay, so I think of this rearguard theory, rearguard research, as an organic logic of research in the sense that it tends to arise out of the I don't want to use the word natural, but out of the usual things that new groups say, lesbian, gay, disability, 1%. Arab Spring, and so forth. When they step on the stage of history, of course, they were always on history, just not on its stage, right? Just not being watched, looked at, and not performing their oppression in public with a lot of haranguing of the dominant groups. Okay, so finally, I want to talk about the new kinds of scientific selves that have emerged from this kind of research. And I remember I started off with Dastan and Gallison talking about the shift to automatic observation with photography in the mid-19th century. And that shift created a moral crisis for those scientists who had been producing those atlases before, right, before automatic photography. The scientists who were supervising the engravers and so forth always testified that they had very carefully monitored what the artist was doing. The artist hadn't been able to insert his own views of violets into the picture. There were no aesthetic qualities that had been entered in. It was very carefully supervised. But now with the coming of photography, it turns out it wasn't supervised enough, one could say, right? If you look at those older prints, they're always perfect examples, right? And the new photographic ones would show the rabbit poop at the bottom of the violets and the broken stems and the background and the they showed the light, different kinds of light, and they did not depict perfect flowers. They depicted what the observer in the Amazon would in fact see, right? And so the photography made a moral bad judgment, judged that the earlier scientists were not achieving right sight. And notice the word right. I mean, that's the word that Dastan and Gallison use, and it's a good one because it's both epistemic and ethical, right? Epistemic and moral. And that's Dastan and Gallison's point, that epistemic positions are always also ethical, moral ones, right? About the goodness of that scientist's research, about the value of those kinds of institutional norms of botany in that era, right? They threw it into disrepute. Excuse me, great one. And so we shouldn't be surprised that when the civil rights movement and feminism and anti-colonialism and so forth came along, it met a lot of resistance from those very careful scientists in every discipline, because we were challenging whether they had right sight. We said, you don't, right? You don't understand how the world really works, because you have posed an ideal, Mr. Nowhere, right? Who can see everywhere from no particular place. I mean, it's like that shift from the engravers to the photographs. And so I picked out three, I'm gonna call them three new kinds of perfect scientific selves. But they may just be aspects of researchers coming out of these movements. And three is just the ones I thought it was good to focus on. But I bet there are more. And I bet you down here in Puebla can think of ones that there's no way I could think up living where I live, even though Spanish is the majority environment in my, majority language in my environment in Los Angeles, and still will, and soon will be in the US, right? Okay, so the three I picked out, and I'll just say a word or two about them, and then we can talk about them more if you want to. The three I picked out were, first of all, the multiple and conflicted self. There's all kinds of examples of this, particularly I teach a philosophy text that uses Lourdes Torres's discussion of the autobiographies of Latin American women, Gloria Anzaldúa, Morales, the Morales mother and daughter, and so Rosario Morales, and I'm sorry if I forget the names. I could look and find them. But the point is that people who live in two cultures feel usually a loyalty to both cultures, and are looking at they're always caught between two different ways of looking at the world. I mean, so let me use Gloria Anzaldúa as the example. The specific borderlands she was talking about was the Tex-Mex border. The title of her book is Borderlands. It might be the most widely taught introduction to women's studies text these days. It's been taught for 20 years or so. It's taught in Germany, it's taught everywhere. It's a beautiful book. Walter Mignolo loved it. He picked it up, stopped citing her as the origin, and used it to characterize decolonial thought in general. And it's a very good way to think about it. And indeed, that has become in that Mignolo and Giselle and so forth, literature has become a way to talk about the Latin American, specifically the Latin American decolonial take. So Anzaldúa specifically was talking about the Tex-Mex border, but she was talking about, somebody counted it up, there's about 16 borders she's talking about. I mean, it's obviously a language border, it's Spanish-English, it's a culture border. She feels loyalty to her homophobic and sexist father and brother. She loves them, even though she's a lesbian, right, and a lesbian feminist. And it's many, many different borders. Another perfect example of this was early feminist talk about problems with the hyphen. Everybody was a socialist feminist, socialist hyphen feminist, a liberal hyphen feminist, a woman hyphen philosopher, right? A feminist hyphen scientist, right? And it was painful. That hyphen was a very painful place to live. You were always wrong on one side or the other. And there's been a lot of writing about the pain of that kind of situation. When I do this discussion in my classes at UCLA, which the undergraduate students, a third of them are Latina, and 45% are Asian or Asian American, right? The whole class knows exactly what this is about. right? And they just come up with example after example, both of the, you know, mostly of the pain is how they come up. But I give them an exercise to bring into class some examples of scientific practices in their families that are not modern scientific ones. And we have a rip-roaring good time with the grandmothers who make them stick their feet in bowls of hot water every time they come in. Food, and see, somebody knows that already. Really a good time. But what feminism figured out was that that was the source of the great creativity of feminism. It was precisely thinking out of that, not this, not that, both, more. Right, something different. And so that the multiple and conflicted self, if one can gather enough social resources together to live through it, right, is really important. It's a very creative, politically creative, ethically creative, epistemically, scientifically creative. It's a very creative way in which to live. And you know what? We have to live that way anyway. It's a shrinking world. You're all traveling, coming from one country to another to do your doctorate. You're on the internet with people from another culture. I mean, globalization has a lot of downsides, a lot, for research and universities. But it also has some upsides. And speaking of the US, it's put very different groups of people in classrooms on both sides of the podium and in publishing houses and so forth. And this is a very, that ferment created is wonderful. Okay, a second kind of important kind of proper scientific self is the one I've been referring to throughout, who locates a research strategically in the world from which she's starting off her research. Participatory action research starts with groups that have already organized, they already know what some of their problems are. And the researcher participates in trying to figure out how to resolve those. And there's lots of examples of this. A big one in the US, and I'm sure there is, I'm sure you can find versions of it in this city, is citizen science or civic science. Okay, every disease now has its survivor's community, right? One of the big studies to look at is Stephen Epstein's study of AIDS research in the 1980s in particular. But, you know, there was a big French one on muscular dystrophy, I think it was. The point of these research projects, in those two ones in particular, were to get the federal governments to start doing research on these diseases. Okay, and so it was the parents of kids with muscular dystrophy and the friends, same with AIDS, right? It was the AIDS victims themselves, but also their loved ones and people who cared about it, who were pressuring the federal government to start putting research in it. All kinds of environmental research. We have a new project that's formed in Los Angeles. How come such a high percentage of children have respiratory problems? Is asthma and respiratory problems have gone way up? Well, the first thing this parents and friends noticed was that a very high percent of elementary schools in Los Angeles are within, I forget what the number is, 500 feet of a freeway. Why? Did the road builders want to kill small children? Why are there so many elementary schools next to freeways in Los Angeles? Cheap land. The city already owned the land. They were the sites where the trucks parked when they put a new lane on the freeway. So the city already owned the land, and so when they needed a new elementary school, they put it in there. So people haven't figured out what to do about it yet, but it's a citizen science movement. It was citizens who gathered the data, who figured it out, who are pressuring the city government and others to do something about this. I mean, we get many days in LA when kids are not allowed to go out for recess. because the pollution is so bad that, it, you know, they're running around with their growing lungs is a bad thing. Okay, so I could say more, but let me stop. Let's say one other thing there and then stop. An interesting kind of new research has emerged on this participatory action research. It's collaborative research. Now that term normally refers, that's not the issue here. It started in archaeology. So it was Western scientists collaborating with the indigenous groups to develop research projects that the indigenous groups wanted. A wonderful guide to it is the work of Alison Wiley, W-Y-L-I-E. She's a philosopher of archaeology and has organized a number of conferences on these kinds of issues. Okay, the final kind of proper scientific self I identified was the self, the scientist who is speaking simultaneously as an individual and as a collective. And a good example is Rigoberto Menchú, right? Who gave an interview in Paris, as you all know. And I think it was a British anthropologist, I forget, who said she lied. It wasn't she who was shot in the leg. It was her cousin. It wasn't she who, whose house was burned down. It was her grandfather. And that debate raged for 10 years. And feminists looked at it and kind of immediately knew what the issue was. That the notion of self being used by the critic is a Western individual self. But Mrs. Johnson and Mrs. Harris and so forth knew that women never get to function as individuals. They're always somebody's wife, somebody's mother, right? That notion of self is a very special notion of self. And indeed, by the end of a decade, the anthropologist who had originally criticized Menchú took it back. He said he now got it. That we're laughing now, but wait till the young ones get on our cases. Right? We're always already wrong. I tell my graduate students that don't ever try to be right. Just try to be least wrong of all and only the hypotheses you've tested for today. That's all scientific method will give you anyway. So it gives you a very different feeling presenting their work if they know they're always already wrong. Somebody's going to stand up in the front row and say, you forgot about, right. Okay, so these are three I picked out, but there are plenty more. One I can't quite get conceptualized, and I've asked people for it and they don't quite do it, but somebody will, is new forms of electronic journalism. In Black Lives Matter, for example, where people's videos are becoming central knowledge in understanding the case and what's going on. And there were a lot of that kind of records in the Egyptian square, right? And there's another aspect of it too here that somebody could conceptualize, I can't figure it out. When stuff goes viral, right, it goes viral, and it's crowdsourcing and knowledge in some way that comes out of these social justice movement projects. Okay, I'm going to conclude. I've run over. I think this social justice research, which is global, happening all over the globe, and the new kinds of proper scientific selves that are being produced are symptoms of what an exciting moment this is to rethink how we produce knowledge and to try to relink that production of knowledge with the pro-democratic, powerful social justice movements. Thank you.